Thank you very much, Leon. I do appreciate that very much, and I appreciate people coming out to listen, and I hope that there's something interesting, as we say with SAA. They're having so many turnaround strategies, they're in a complete spin at the moment. Anyway, we see if the next one will fly, I'm not sure. I thought a lot of things happen, and what we often don't, in our daily lives, we're so busy with what I call transactional stuff, and that's important that one does that and gets that right, because one is, you know, going through, just coming through here took me probably about an additional 20 minutes that wasn't necessary because of traffic lights that were out. I don't know why we can't get traffic lights to work. And there were potholes and all of these things. And this is transactional. And this is what often gets us down when there's no electricity and when there's no water. We really become fresh and that type of thing. But these things are not always the most important thing. And we often miss things that are actually critically important and that are turning points. Now, I've entitled the presentation The Second Watershed. So in a sense, we need to unpack what the first watershed was. And I'm going to talk about that first watershed in terms of the context of where we find ourselves and what were the success factors of those watersheds. Now, in terms of law and all that, I'm a homemade lawyer, and there's a lot of people in this audience, including Leon Lowe himself, or got legal knowledge that is much better than mine and that type of thing. So we see how we go on that particular thing. But I'm going to take you through that first watershed and why there were the success factors that there were, and then the second watershed, and try and understand that in that thing. And what are the consequences? And I'm going to unpack that. Why do we find ourselves in such a difficult position at the moment? And then just briefly look at the investment consequences going forward. And the first thing is to look at this, and in fact we write about this in the book that Leon mentioned, so I've got to give that a little bit of a punt, that certain countries have, in fact many countries, go through these big transitions. And when it comes to the BRICS, it's no exception that our countries have gone through big transitions, and almost, within the same decade. So Brazil, for instance, emerged from a military dictatorship and a hyperinflation, right? That had a huge impact on Brazil, right? But they've come through that. They've got challenges at the moment, we can see that. But we need to understand why they behave like they do. But South Africa certainly was no exception. And I'm going to outline two transitions that had South Africa and the Soviet Union, which morphed into Russia. And there were two enormous transitions. As you can appreciate, when the Iron Curtain came down, it had a momentous effect on world affairs. But it was interesting, that transition that took place from the Soviet Union, from the communist era to the era that they've got now, was utter chaos. And South Africa, in contrast, very shaky. And remember, the fall of the wall brought great hope. And especially with the end of the Cold War, great hope in terms of what could happen now that you've got effectively free market forces and you're ending the communism, and communism is one of the problems that the Russians don't want to know. They don't want to go back to communism, but what are they going to? And South Africa, in contrast, from 1990 to 1994, it was by no means settled. We were going already in KwaZulu-Natal, a low-level civil war. Okay, the 94 election came, if you remember, the IFP joined the, the election on the, not the 11th hour, the 13th hour, they had to put stickers on the ballot papers or reprint them, whatever, just to accommodate them. But it was so important that they were accommodated. Okay. The administration of that 94 election was unbelievable, right? To the point that I don't even know if the ballots were counted. I think they got into a room and just negotiated, you know. I don't know what it, you know, what it was, but the point is we didn't do that. But post-94, the country settled down very quickly. Now, what was the big difference? And the difference there was the institutions that were negotiated in CODESA 1, CODESA 2, and following. And in the Soviet Union, it was Yeltsin came in, turned a switch, and said, okay, now we don't have communism anymore, and descended into chaos. And it's those institutions that we negotiated. Yeah? Some of them are quite, you know, I don't think have made much impact, like the Human Rights and Gender Commission and that kind of thing. But there were some key institutions that effectively helped to settle down the country quite quickly. All right, things like the prosecuting authority, right, independent prosecuting authority, all citizens effectively fall in the law. The Auditor General giving the financial oversight of what happens in government. The public protector, and we know that the role of the public protector more recently, but it gives people redress when they're dealing with officialdom and they're not getting their luck. They can actually go to the public protector, all right, and at least get some an alternative channel of redress, etc. Parliament, as an as an oversight body over the executive, the Independent Electoral Commission, whereas 1994 I think was chaotic, subsequent elections I think were worthy of what would be a triple A rated country. Right, you actually had elections which people had confidence in. So in the previous election, not this last one, but the previous one, you had what was happening. You had the DA was fighting the ANC, ANC was fighting the DA, COPE and IFP were fighting themselves, whatever, but nobody was fighting the IEC because people had confidence in that. And that's important, because if you don't have confidence in the system, right, there's problems. And the independent judiciary, absolutely critical, especially when it comes to the bedding down of contracts. And so this didn't happen in the Soviet Union, right? And so it was a bit of a wild west. Crime rose, I think it rose here as well, but that wasn't because of the democracy, but it was in the Soviet Union, it was because of the central authority that really didn't have proper systems and citizens that didn't have decent redress. So what were the success factors that we can actually point to? And the implications from the investment point of view is, firstly, we bedded down quite quickly. What happened subsequent to 94 is that people operated within the system. Now, if you operating the government, that's quite important, that you don't have people operating outside the system. So whether it's extreme left or extreme right or whatever you want to cook up, the people operating in the system. I don't like what the government's doing, I take them to court. I don't like what the thing, I'm going to stand for elections. These are operating within the system, and that was important. And why is that we've got confidence in the courts? Because there's independence. The military, we demilitarized quite quickly. In fact, one of the big advantages is that our military has become, you know, fairly useless, and that's quite nice. Okay. All right. Because when you're looking at tyrannies, it's nice to actually have a strong army, a nice air force that can fly over, you know, opening of parliament and that kind of thing. So, and I think in the 80s, you know, from a point of view of the tax burden that it costs just to maintain that, to have a nice military is very nice. But usually in times of trouble, they use the military against your own people. And that stopped from 94, it actually stopped. and it was de-escalated to a voluntary mode. We had oversight bodies like the Scorpions that could actually investigate independent of the police, which is still connected to the executive, and a free press, right, where you could say anything you like, but and not go to jail for it, or not be intimidated. The second that we need to understand is that the investment implications when you're acting in a constitutional manner, in other words, when there's constitutionality in a country, and this is what's often not understood, is and I'm speaking to the Free Market Foundation, and people often think, oh, regulation and free markets don't go together. A free market is a regulated market. If the regulations are there to lower barriers to entry and level the playing field. When you talk about regulations, most people say you're going to have regulations because of market failure. And I never, ever hear people talk about regulatory failure. All right, never. All right, but let's say you give market failure, well, then your regulations must then help the market to work better, not just work against the market. All right, and in a success, all right, the one thing is investor confidence is critical for a successful economy. And I know that sounds very airy-fairy, but one of the principles that even Nobel laureate economists do not understand is that to bring new economic activity into existence, you have to have investment. Okay? There's other things. You can add skills, you can add technology, all of those, but you can have technology without investment. You won't get new economic activity coming into existence. It's as simple as that. You have to have investment. And the only resource that funds investment is savings. There is no other resource that funds investment. And again, you can do the sums and you can wave your magic wand and say but and all the rest of it. At the end of the day, savings funds investment, investment funds growth. Okay, and that's a critical understanding, especially when you need to expand an economy that in South Africa that was needed to be transformed from basically a 5 million people economy to a 50 million people economy. And that was essential. And so when you're operating within a constitutionality, right, those property rights help investor confidence. That's entrenched in the Constitution. And I suspect Leon would always say the Free Market Foundation was instrumental in embedding that in the Constitution. You'll see how frustrating it is to politicians who are more takers than makers. Okay. Because it prevents just wholesale taking. But contract enforcement is also important. You know, in a country like Kenya, you've got banks will lend you money at something like 30%, and if you deposit, you'll get 6%, you know, that kind of thing. And you say, but surely there's an opportunity here to drive through that thing. And the reason is you can't enforce contracts. So if you lend money, you've got to be compensated pretty decently for that, all right? And be very, very, very careful, because if you lend money and it doesn't come back, it's actually quite costly, certainly if you're a lending institution. And so enforcement of contracts is important. If you borrow money, you pay it back. If you said you're going to do this, it can be, it's important. But another concept that I find extremely important is what I call an investment timeline. Now, I'm using it in a very philosophical sense, but you can tell a country that's got a short investment timeline. And different investments have different lengths of timeline. For instance, retailing has got quite a short investment timeline. You put your money in, you get it back reasonably quickly. Mining, on the other hand, is a very long investment timeline. You've really got to have a long line of sight to actually say, do I invest or not? And even that becomes opaque because of the variability that takes place. The thing that you tell about a country with a short investment timeline, the first thing that you see is the infrastructure shot. because infrastructure is one of those things that require a long investment timeline. And you could see this in a country like Brazil, where you're not managing the macros properly and you've got hyperinflation. How do you finance a project, right, for 30 years with a 60% interest rate? You don't. Doesn't happen. Okay? And so you get that deterioration in infrastructure, and the country's held back as a consequence. And so constitutionality is important for the investment timelines. One of the big growth unlocks in Africa has been the increasingly prevalence of good elections. Now, again, you can point to the countries, you know, can almost name them with your 10 fingers, but when Nigeria has an election and a peaceful handover of power after the election, all right, that's a good sign, because from a business point of view, if you don't have constitutionality and you're trying to actually operate under the patronage of whoever came into power, His Most High Honorable Excellency President for Life, who came to power in a coup, you don't know how long he's going to be there, all right? So you make hay while the sun shines and ship everything you can offshore. But the moment you start having a government that's acting in a constitutional way, your business plans and investment plans can go through those political cycles. All right? And so what happens? You start to invest into the business. Competitors come in and your investment timelines shoot out, and you start to actually, and the country benefits from that. So investment timelines are regarded as quite important. The other concept that is not well understood, and you can hear that very often academics, you know, universities of the pink kind, you know, they haven't a clue how the resources are generated to pay their salaries every month. Even people who work in business don't understand it, but civil servants are even worse. All right. And this is one thing one must get. There is no other source of wealth generation in a society other than through some sort of business or enterprise activity. Okay? There is no. So when you listen to Bladman and Randy talking, all right, you know he doesn't understand how the resources are built up to buy his luxury cars and all the rest of it and ministerial salary. He hasn't a clue. Sorry, I'm being personal. I try not to do that. All right. So that's what I'm trying to say here, is that unfortunately in this country, economics is discussed. You can see with the National Development Plan, it's a centre-left policy, it's a social democrat plan, if you put it in a European context. Economics is, in South Africa, is discussed between the centre-left and loony-left. It's not it's not discussed like in Europe between centre-left, centre-right, that kind of thing. All right, but that's in its own problem. All right, but what we need to point out is that since then we've had a second watershed, and it was a major watershed, and it was something that didn't affect our lives. The dirty hospitals. And we know money's been set aside for these dirty hospitals. Where the hell is it? And the hospitals are still dirty. And the schools aren't functioning. The bloody pothole took out my tire. Right? These are the transactional things that worry us because it affects us in our daily lives. But the second watershed was actually a hell of a lot more important and affected nobody on the day it happened, and that's when the charges were dropped against Zuma. Okay. That was the beginning of the second watershed, culminating in Polokwane. So the first watershed, unbanning of the ANC and release of Mandela in 1990, culminating in the 94 election. A long process, negotiated, etc. The moment you drop the charges against Zuma, those institutions that make South Africa strong and gave the confidence in the country started to be compromised. Because the moment that happens, and I'm not making a judgment whether there's guilt or not guilt. It's the point is that when you actually generate impunity, who gets impunity? Well, the president gets impunity, maybe his cabinet, and eventually get to like Zimbabwe. If it's associated with the ruling party, just don't bother. It's not worth the trouble. And you get this bridled, unbridled problem. And so what, let's go through this. We have Polokwane, okay? In the aftermath, we get rid of the scorpions. That's part of the why? Because the scorpions are investigating Zuma. If they weren't investigating Zuma and, you know, left Zuma untouched, I think they might still exist, okay? But that wasn't their task. They're going for it. We have this leftward policy shift, okay? We throw these bombs into the business sector, and then we quickly try and do damage control and say, phew, okay, that wasn't as bad, but we've still shifted, right? With the regulatory excess, etc. And then you had the purge. Are you in the right camp, you know? Because we can't have people that are going to dissent. And so you start, and again, you don't notice at the time, because these things unfold over time. The start of a tyranny, okay? The ring of steel around the center person, all right? That ring of steel, how do you do it? With loyalists. How do you create loyalty? Through the security thing, security file. You'll be loyal, because if you're not loyal, I've got dirt on you. Okay, so Malema discovered that, right? You step out of line, you lose all your stuff, and you get, you know, you get targeted to get thrown into jail. That's why I was, you know, to me, Malema, I have very little time for, I've got less polite words, but the, when SARS couldn't progress their case, I was delighted. Because how dare government use an institution like SARS to attack its citizens like that? How dare they? All right, but they do that, and we sit there quiet, and we don't want to dissent. All right, so that I believe was a very good thing. All right, even though, you know, I don't, you know, have much time for that. But that purge, we also start seeing the clash of systems. Rural versus urban. We have a rural president. Okay, now that's quite important to understand, because in rural South Africa we have feudal systems. Okay, now feudal systems, you don't pay tax, you pay tributes. And when you pay that tribute, this happened in Europe when it was, and India and China, where you had feudal systems, and all over the world, where you pay tributes, that tribute becomes the personal property of who you pay it. So you're not paying it into a fiscus. All right. And so when you ask rural South Africa, you know, what about Nkandla? They say, well, what's the problem? He is the boss. He should build himself a lovely palace out of public funds. And yet in an urban constitutional democracy, it's plain and utter theft. All right. And that's the difference. Okay. And so we've seen a whole lot of problems since then. Concentrating power. Shifting power away from parliament and into the hands of the minister. Common criticism. But that didn't start with Zuma. That actually started beforehand. Okay. Rewarding failure. Okay. Because it's loyalists that count. Spending priorities. No money for students, but we've got money for jet. So it's interesting. Okay. In terms of spending power. And the irony is lost. The state intrusion into the economy. Greater state intrusion, but greater effect, ineffectiveness of that state. And so in a sense, whereas you've got an anti-privatization, and as Gwede Mantashe says, privatization is going down an ideological route that is not even on the table, okay? Yet government ineffectiveness and ineptness has created a great deal of privatization in terms of where we get our schooling, our health, our security. Even in law, if you've got a dispute with somebody, it's much better just to agree that we get an arbitrator and settle with that. That's also privatizing the law, okay, in terms of conflict resolution. And that's part of the problem of state failure and rewarding failure and doing populism, and that comes with a rising tax burden. So you're getting the first signs in a modern society of a tax revolt, okay? And I believe that the Etol saga and the student thing is has got linkages to that. Okay. Then what's also important is that what we're seeing is funnies happening. The institutional compromise, police and parliament, must be the most anti-democratic gesture that's been pushed in. Even the nationalists didn't do that. Okay, that they didn't target. You know, they surveilled. You know, they had surveillance on politicians they didn't like, but then they didn't go and arrest them. You've got the suspensions. You know, the off with your head type of running things, but you're also placing inept leadership. All right, the police sort of being case in point. Marikana, I believe, was also an institution. Here you've got labor laws, etc., that are in favor of the worker, unequivocally, and here you have this whole group of people acting outside the system, no longer trusting the system. Okay, and that's a concern. And then the state functionality deteriorating. And then you have al-Bashir, okay, flouting of the rule of law. Now, I agree. And this is where I do have a lot of sympathy for the government, etc. Arresting Bashir would have been hellishly inconvenient politically. I can't tell you how inconvenient that would have been. Funny enough, you wouldn't have had universal condemnation across Africa, okay? But you certainly would have amongst the authoritarian side of Africa. They would have been incensed. Okay, and that would have excised South Africa out of the diplomatic community, and that's the difficulty. Okay. The problem is, if you're going to ignore politically inconvenient court rulings, right, it's not a long shot to start ignoring court rulings that are commercially inconvenient. Just think the farmers. The government comes and says, I'm going to take your farm. Thank you very much. And the farmer says, near what? Here I'm going to take the government to court. And the judge said to government, give the farm back. And the government says, no. Now what? Okay. You've got no redress, you know, once the government starts to do that. And if you... Because property rights is something that comes under the protection of the courts, and if you're going to ignore that, okay, you actually, and it's not a long shot. So here it's a politically inconvenient ruling, and it's not the first ruling they've actually ignored or flouted, etc. The spy tapes are an example of that. But you start to become a patronage economy where you target the wealth producers in favor of the wealth and the rent seekers. So you start to, and rent seeking is people who look for a free lunch, and we've got too much of that. All right, rent seeking in the economy, but basically this helps to cement it and intensify it, and that's the difficulty that we face. But I must say, for every force there's an equal and opposite reaction. That's my physics background coming into it, because the Constitution is actually fighting back. Jude Linister, by his own sort of initiative, took the government to court on the scorpions issue, and the government lost. The government is losing court cases, right? When they actually attacked the judiciary actually stood up, right, and said, that's just not on. That was extremely positive, okay? The public protector has also been a lone wolf. I can promise you when her term comes to an end, they will be appointing somebody much more compliant than that at the next time. But even the court cases, such as the spy tapes, the government is losing these things when it comes to matters of constitutional principle. Okay, and that's encouraging. All right, but unfortunately, to keep the charges away, you have to continue to compromise the institutions. So we're heading to what I call as a dirty democracy. We'll still have elections, but do you really trust the ISC? We'll still have court cases, but do you have full confidence in the outcome? That's the thing that happens when you continue to erode the institutions. So I'm hoping that doesn't happen, but we need to be careful, because we've got under this a number of consequences. And where do we find ourselves economically as a consequence? And the first thing I'm just going to run through is what I call our three triples. Okay, government would say, right, our problem is poverty, inequality, and unemployment. And I would suggest that it's mainly an unemployment problem from which there's a poverty and inequality consequence. But the policy has been focusing on inequality and poverty. All right. And we can see this in the tax system and that kind of thing, which I'll outline. But if you have full employment, inequality is a greatly diminished problem. You don't necessarily solve it, but it's a diminished problem, if it's a problem, you know, at all. The second is poverty is a greatly diminished problem, even if it's not fully solved. But even things like housing, people who work are able to keep a roof over their heads better than people who don't work. Health, it's not that people who work don't get ill, but you have a tendency that people who don't work as a group are sicker than people who do. Okay, education. People who work keep their kids in school for longer than people who don't. And if everybody's working, you've got much less time to plan the next heist. It even helps with crime. Okay. And that's why I'm saying, as a policy thing, we should be looking at unemployment, but we're not doing that. Because we are increasingly making what I call is our triple mistake. Right. And labor unrest, look how it's exploded since 2008. Okay, up until 2008, you actually had the point. In fact, 2007 started to rise because they were agitating to get rid of Mbeki. But up until then, South Africa had started to get a reputation of actually quite good, stable labor relations. But you've got to try and remember that. There were some motor manufacturers say that actually labor is more stable here than in Germany. Okay, and that was an interesting observation. But with labor unrest, nobody in the whole wide world invests in labor unrest. And it's not to say that, you know, we're the only country with labor unrest. It's just that when you look at the World Economic Forum, we come right at the bottom of the pops, right, when it comes to labor unrest. So we do it better than most. All right. The second is regulation. Okay, and there's three problems with the regulations that we have. Firstly, it's hideously expensive, all right? So when you're trying to grow an economy and you're shifting resources away from potential growth to regulation, that's a hassle. It needs economies of scale to be compliant, which means you're shutting out small business. And a lot of the regulation is just shifting blame from perpetrators to bystanders and victims. Just think of it, Poppy, this is the protection of personal information. Here you are working at your desk, right, all innocently, and somebody steals information off your desk, and suddenly you're going to jail. Not the perpetrator. Yeah, you're a teller, you're accepting money and, you know, depositing stamp, thank you very much, and suddenly you're going to jail because some wonk comes along and says, we think that's financing terrorism. And the hassle with things like FICA is, are you financing terrorism? Are you financing terrorism? Are you finding, none of us are financing terrorism, but the authorities are so focused on our transactions that since laws like FICA has come into power, terrorism financing has gone through the roof, because the people who do terrorism financing and that sort of thing now know the rules that they need to circumvent. It's the same thing with the Department of Home Affairs and child trafficking. Are you trafficking children? No. Are you trafficking children? Nobody's here trafficking children, but the authorities are now focused on your children. And if that had stuck, if it sticks around, child trafficking will soar, because you now know the authorities, we know what the authorities are looking for. All right, so if you're going to traffic a child, you know what not to flag. It's as simple as that. So you're using these things in place of good crime intelligence, all right, and you're just then abdicating responsibility, whether it's FICA, FASE, it doesn't really matter. You're transferring blame to a perpetrator. So just as it's wrong to go and arrest a woman for being raped because she wore a short dress, Okay? It's nothing to do whether it was clever to wear a short dress through that part of town. It doesn't give anybody the right to rape. And like, if I leave my cell phone here, it doesn't give somebody the right to take it. Even if I could be described as stupid for doing that, all right, it shouldn't be making me culpable. All right, and that's the point of the problem with regulation. So that's just my problem with regulation. And then taxes, increasingly, because of this obsession with inequality, we are taxing capital formation. Remember, capital funds investment, which funds growth, that linkage there. And when you're taxing capital formation, it's like eating seeds and then wondering why you aren't getting harvests, especially when you're in a capital deficient environment with such a huge unemployment. So that's the hassle. And with this, we've got the slow puncture. World competitiveness, we're sinking down the rankings. Corruption perception, sinking down. Freedom of the press, sinking down the rankings. Ease of doing business, sinking. So different organizations, and all of these rankings you can pull holes in, all right? But when the World Bank does their survey, they don't have anything against South Africa, but we're slipping down their particular rankings. The World Economic Forum, slipping down their rankings. Economic freedom, plunging down those rankings, as it were. And we can see that the slow growth is self-inflicted, all right, as we get there. But with the triple mistakes, we've also developed the triple deficit, okay. In 2008, we go into the 2008 crisis with a budget surplus. All right, we did have a current account deficit, so that was quite a big deficit, and that closed. But savings have slipped into negative. So we've got we've got a deficit with the rest of the world. We've got the government with a deficit with the rest of the country, and households or the tax base that's also in deficit. Right. And why it's important to understand we've got three deficits is when you've got a government that thinks the tax base is an unlimited deep resource, you know we're running into trouble because it's all in deficit. But I'd like to examine this particular deficit, the current account deficit. In the 2000s, the current account deficit starts to widen. We've got a strong currency and a booming economy. You would expect that. Then the global crisis hits and the current account deficit closes, and then it starts to widen again post the global financial crisis, this time with a weakening exchange rate and a slowing economy. Weakening exchange rate, slowing economy should have put this into a strong surplus. And that says since 2008, we are losing competitiveness on a massive scale. Right, and this is what I want you to appreciate. Since 2008, you can now start seeing the inflection point that occurred in our economy. There's one thing that happened in 2008, which is the biggest distraction, and that's called the global financial crisis for South Africa. The global financial crisis was exactly that. It was global. It hit everybody. I know you've got a slightly different take on that, but it's global. All right, so you would expect a similar effect across the world, and there certainly was that. All right, but with this, we've got economic mismatch, an investment rate of 19%, but a savings rate of 14%. That mismatch is one of the reasons we've got this triple deficit and eroding into the resilience of the country. Okay, and we want the National Development Plan wants an investment rate of 30%. We can't even sustain 19%. A 19% investment rate will buy you a 2-3% long run growth rate. That's what you'll get with a 19% investment rate. We need to be investing at 30% to get your growth rate up to 6-7%. All right, and 6-7% is very, very possible, but you've got to actually build your savings rate to 30% as well, okay? So that you've got that resilience. Okay, so let's have a look. Unemployment. This is Brazil and South Africa. Unemployment coming down for Brazil and South Africa. You've got two different scales, by the way, because we're in the 20% and they're in the thing. But the point is, up until 2008, both coming down, Brazil, after 2008, remember the global financial crisis also hit Brazil. Keeps coming down, ours goes up, which is the aberration. So you look around emerging markets and you find that South Africa is one of the only emerging markets, bar like Venezuela or some other countries run by crackpots, that has got a higher unemployment now than what we had in 2008. All right, and that means the aberration is here, okay? Because if the global financial crisis was global, you'd expect to see similar patterns. And basically, you can see this in a number of areas. Electricity production, you had the emerging market crisis there where it sort of came back, but largely upward trend. We've never had such a long period of decline in electricity production. And this is, I know there's been load shedding in 2008 that led to that, but there's been hardly any load shedding in between that. The slowdown in the economy is one of the reasons why we've had that. So the 2008, I believe, has been a distraction. Business confidence, for instance, there's the emerging market crisis. That was a big crisis. Business confidence came up, the commodity boom, etc. And now we've had the slow puncture type of thing with business confidence falling to basically the levels that it was still in 2000, etc. And our economy, as a consequence, has entered a stagflation trap. The first thing is that inflation, which was trending down, has started to trend up. Okay, you had this as an aberration when the rand, you know, hit a level and the growth hit a peak. But since it rectified, you had a rebound in growth, and it's since trended down. Most emerging markets rebounded back to where they were in 2007, 2008. All right, South Africa is down. Okay, most emerging markets managed to achieve that rebound with the GDP, their debt to GDP ratios at the same level. We've managed to double our debt to GDP ratios, all right, and get half the growth, in fact, a quarter of the growth that we had before. And so we've got the stagflation condition because inflation is rising, and as the Reserve Bank is saying, inflation is high and the risks are to the upside. Growth is low and the risks are to the downside. Now, stagflation is an interesting one because the term came about in the 70s, where normally you'd have, when growth picks up, you then start to go against the production constraints of the economy, so prices start to pick up, so you need to constrain the economy, and then inflation would come down, but growth would come down as well, and so you get these cycles that you had in the 50s and the 60s, etc. The 70s come along, and inflation picks up and stays up, whereas growth goes down and stays down. And that was something that really vexed economists at the time. And we came up with terms like cost push inflation and demand pull inflation, all of these things. But the cure for stagflation was interesting. And I don't think it was ever seen as you do these three things to cure cure stagflation. But it came as the necessities of the time. One of the things, it ended, you had privatization. It ended the what I call the government business model. Now, the government business model is quite nice. They say, what are my costs and what do I need to charge to cover my costs? Very nice business model. All right, the private sector business model is, what will the market bear and what must my costs look like for me to be in that market? So the moment you had privatization, it ended the cost push inflation that you had in Britain and America and that kind of thing. The second thing that they did is they cut tax rates. In the UK, you had a 90% marginal tax rate. In other words, if you earned above a certain amount, the government said, I'll take that, thank you very much. Okay, and by cutting the tax rates, you're then shifting resources back to the private sector from low multiply activity to higher multiply activity. And the third measure was sky high interest rates. The US, I think, went to 20% at one stage. Volcker, I think, for anybody who's borrowing money, was the devil incarnate at the time. But basically, you shifted the balance back to the saver, because monetary policy is favors the borrower over the saver. And so you had savings in the private sector that could drive the growth. And from the mid-80s right to 2000, you had the opposite of the stagflation 70s, you had these Goldilocks economies. Growth that stayed persistently high, inflation staying persistently low. All right. Again, that puzzled economists. But the reason is you take these things. Now, you take South Africa, we're doing none of that. We are privatization. Gwede Mantashe doesn't want to know. Tax rates, we're raising our taxes, and interest rates we're going to keep very low. So we've got the Reserve Bank meeting tomorrow. I think they almost have to hike if they want to retain any inflation-fighting credibility. But let's see. They're focusing on growth. And so we are entrenching the stagflation condition. I hope that makes you all feel better. But then, the cherry on the top. All right. Remember, this leftward shift in policy is, in fact, the government budget. And I used to call these four expenditure bombs. And then the NSA starts to monitor your emails and your phone calls. So I thought, let me just call them expenditure threats. All right. And each one of them by themselves can take South Africa to a solvency crisis. The public sector wage bill, that's well over 10%, I think pushing even 13% of GDP. All right, our peers sit around about 5% of GDP on the public sector wage bill. Phew. All right, and that's not under control. This year they said we'd stick to 5.7% increase, and it's now over 10%. That's what's going to happen, the result. We're trying to pretend we're keeping that under control, but behind that is national health insurance, and this the National Treasury will tell you that's a step change in the tax burden that we face. Okay, we already had to raise taxes to sort that one out, to try and mitigate that. That represents another increase in the tax burden. Remember, on a tax base that is in deficit. Okay. Then there's the parastatals. parastatals need hundreds of billions in capital to fund their losses, which are getting even more bizarre. Petra SA sort of set the record, but there's others' records to follow. Okay. The inefficiencies are mind-blowing. Remember Eskom, they raised the prices of electricity to pay for Kasuli and Medupi. Right, and we had enormous increase. That was profitable, by the way, at the time for the electricity, but obviously not profitable enough to pay for the capex. So you raise the price of electricity to pay for the capex. They now can't cover operating expenses with that increase in electricity prices. And they still have to fund Kasuli and Medupi. Okay, so hundreds of billions, already a lot of that is becoming a ward of the state. And if you're not going to do any privatization, including partial privatization, that money has to come from the taxpayer, which is in deficit. Okay, and the cherry on the top is nuclear. Okay, we know we don't have a few trillion lying around to pay for nuclear plants. So the thought is to get the Russians to own, build and operate the nuclear plants. We'll just buy the electricity. That's nice. Except that we'll be paying for it in dollars. It'll be in promise. It'll mean that we'll effectively be importing electricity, right, in one sector that we've always been domestically bound, and on top of the current account deficit. So you can imagine when the rand weakens, your electricity prices go up and you've got no resilience to that. So it's just interesting. We're not just going to do one of these, we're going to do all four of them. Okay. All right. So expect there to be problems from a solvency point of view of the crisis. I hope you're feeling better. I'm trying to be positive. The only positive you're going to get tonight is unfortunately going to be HIV. All right. Then how are the systems being devised? Remember, some of it's not just Zuma, it's happened beforehand. You can tell the day the mining sector went X growth. The day. Do you remember that day? It was in 2001, where the mining shares were actually had been going up quite well, because you had the weakness of the rand at the time. And what happened? On a single day, the mining shares lost a hell of a lot because we tossed the... Do people want tell me, why were we born? Okay, if you listen to how people talk, we were born, human beings were born to do two things, okay? One is to pay taxes, and if you couldn't pay taxes, receive welfare. That's your lot in life, according to the powers that be. And I'm saying, government is there to serve us, should be, okay? It should never be an end in itself. Likewise, business should never be an end in itself. Ultimately, people need to be the beneficiaries of what government does and what businesses do. Too big to fail is an example of a business that's become an end in itself. Too big to fail is too big to exist, actually. All right. And yes, it's disruptive if these too big to fail went down. But the moment they go down, they're no longer sucking resources out of society. Businesses are there to make money because they feed society as a consequence. Loss makers suck resources out. And we saw this in the global financial crisis. And we're trying to prop up these things. What we're not seeing is investment, because we're trying to deal with inequality and poverty, but we're not trying to actually address it properly. So we've got this problem of we focused on poverty alleviation, which is shifting resources to consumption, whereas poverty reduction is shifting resources to investment. Not many people make that distinction, by the way, and they use the terms interchangeably, but they're very different. Poverty reduction versus poverty alleviation. And the poverty alleviation we're doing are starting to get in the way of poverty reduction. We're starting to perpetuate the problems that we run. Then we've got the student protests. And again, it's, I think, partly when the middle class is joining in on that. And the middle class is joining. Now, the middle class don't want any trouble. How many people do you know have got an e-tag because they don't want any trouble? Sorry, I hope I'm not offending anybody here. They don't want any trouble, okay? But here you've had the middle class actually standing up and saying enough, all right? Which is interesting, all right? And I think you've got some very real issues. There's no money for students, but there's money from Kandla. The parasitals, service delivery, okay? More than 16,000 protest deliveries, e-tolls, just too much. The budget priorities, as if there's unlimited resources when you want to spend money on ministerial handbooks, but very limited resources when it comes to actually serving the actual population as such. And this economic stagnation that's come about as a result. And that economic stagnation is then compounding a vicious circle. All right. But I think the students doth, as I say, protest too much. All right. The students that are protesting now, the one critical question that hasn't been asked, that needs to be answered, is if you're protesting, what's your year mark? What's your year mark? Because why on earth would you be protesting if you don't do that? But I think free is the utopian nightmare. All right, you want to pay fees. All right, and you can see this in primary and secondary education. This government already has no-fee schools. The no-fee schools have the shortest queues to get in. The highest-fee schools have the longest queues to get in. That's strange, isn't it? So I wonder what the difference is. It might be quality. If any of the students get injured, and we really don't hope they get injured, but certainly if that should unfortunately happen, would they choose to go to a no-fee hospital or a high-fee hospital? Just curious. And the point is that fees actually help to deliver quality, certainly in the South African context. And we can see this even in countries like the UK, where you pay fees in England, but in Scotland, sorry Chris, you don't pay fees, and the Scottish universities are looking increasingly run down and derelict as a result, because the government doesn't have enough money to do that, and especially in Europe, where you've got an aging population and you get more votes by spending it on old people than young people, you know, why would you be having the best universities when you actually need the best old age homes, all right, you know, to stay in power, all right. So basically, I'm just saying, there's even if the government didn't have maladministration and wastage and all the rest of it, right, where does the money come from? So the students want it to be spent on them, so do we take it away from the nurses? Or do we take it from the teachers? Or should we take it from the police? Where should we get the money from? Or take it out of the taxpayers? Why not? They've got an unlimited deep resource. These things need to be obviously thought through, but priorities do need to be, you know, do need to be placed. I'm coming to the towards the end. I'm just going to do one investment consideration, and that's the currency. I will take. Do you remember Die Data? Oh hell, do we remember Die Data? You've bought it. It goes to 73 rand. You buy more at 70 because the analysts are saying buy, and it comes all the way down to 2 rand. Nobody's interested. Hell's teeth. At 2 rand, it's the buy of the century because it bounces back to 10, 11 rand. It was always a 10, 11 rand share. Okay, never 73 rand share, but it's certainly. You can buy it at 2 rand because the parameters are reasonably stable. The thing's not going out of business. Another share drops from 40 rand, drops to 6 rand. Buy, it's a bargain. But in actual fact, it's worth naught. It's African Bank. All right. But people are buying. Why? Because the parameters are not stable. Okay. And that's why you don't buy it. So now we've got a rand that is hideously undervalued. Right. In other words, it's very cheap, certainly if you take normal measures. But are the parameters around it stable? All right. And given the fact that we've had the second watershed, okay, and that the government finances, as part of your leftward shift, is unstable and unsustainable, this trend could continue. You know, one of the bulldust terms we throw around is volatility. You know, markets were volatile. Okay, the one thing about the rand is that it's been surprisingly unvolatile in this trend. It's just that it's come from the 6 rand level right up to 14 rand 40. Ouch. And this is a stable trend. If it trends to that, to just 2 years forward, we're at 18 to the dollar. The trouble is, these things don't just trend. You can't forecast like that. All right. So if you think that the parameters around the rand are stable, you would buy the rand because it is very cheap. But if it's not stable, in other words, it's more like an African bank situation and we're heading to a solvency crisis, let me tell you, if we have to ask the IMF for money, the rand is not at 18 or even 16, it's at 30 or worse. Right, because what happens, these things accelerate. No government likes to ask the IMF for money. The IMF will lend you money, but they do something very, very, very nasty and spiteful. Now, so we will lend you money as long as you stop doing the things that got you into trouble in the first place. Now, you've no idea how spiteful it is when your civil service is part of your vote-catching gimmick and you have to now fire civil servants and cut back your grants and all of that type of thing. All right, and that's the problem with an unstable budget. They say it's pro-poor, but it's very anti-poor, because when you cut these things back, those are the first people that have to pay for it. All right, because you couldn't sustain it. All right, it's like Greece. They say people who don't understand what's happening, they'll say, look at Greece. You can see austerity doesn't work. Why are we choosing austerity as a policy? And the point about that is they've lost it. No politician on earth chooses austerity. Never ever will it be choice. Austerity is a policy consequence, not a policy choice. As Cyprus discovered, have a referendum, say, and the referendum says no to austerity. All right. And so they tell the Europe, you see, democracy, no austerity. So what was the choice? They either had austerity light by the European Union or austerity cold turkey without the Europe. They chose austerity light. Okay. Because the other side of no austerity is a lot more debt. And the Greeks found that the queue to lend their money was actually very short. And so they had to go for the soft loans, which looks hard, but the soft loans. Why? Because if they didn't get the loans, they couldn't pay their pensions and the civil service salaries. Sure, that sounds like when this money runs out, they're back in trouble. Because they're borrowing money for consumption reasons. And this is where you get the, what I call the systemic corruption of political establishments. There's transactional corruption. You know, we spent, you know, 1 trillion rand on nuclear power stations and we can't account for 400 billion. That's transactional. Okay. Systemic corruption is what you find in Europe. They vote the expenditure. They've ticked every governance box. You can track every cent that is spent, but they should never have voted for that expenditure because they're voting consumption expenditure and kicking that can down the road. They are throwing their country under a bus. In other words, they are behaving in a treasonous way by spending money on welfare and borrowing it to make the difference. All right, but this is what we've had. But there is hope, and I'm going to end up with that, is just to have a look at what can be done. This is South Africa's GDP per capita in 1980. That's Chile's, just under South Africa. That's Mauritius. And there's China. China was a basket case in 1980. It was absolutely a basket case. You had Chairman Mao, who did China an enormous favor in the mid-70s by dying. And in doing that, it enabled the reforms that started in the beginning of the 80s, towards the end of the 70s and beginning of the 80s, and China started to their long road to recovery. And that's because, not because they've got central planning, but because they've had less of it, that they're now the second largest economy on earth. It depends on whether you're doing PPP, it could even be the largest, you know, if you believe the measures and all the rest of it. But the point is, there is Mauritius. Bless their hearts. There is nothing going for Mauritius. Nice beaches is not a competitive advantage. Okay. East London's got nice beaches. And their attitude, I mean, if you take off from Oatambo, heading for Mauritius, and the pilot gets it wrong by a quarter of a degree, you miss Mauritius by miles. Okay. All right. In 1980, the average Mauritian cut cane, sewed clothes together, and served as waiters. That's what in their hotels. That's what the average Mauritian did in 1980. All right. And their attitude was, why would anybody on earth deliberately seek Mauritius out to come and invest and do business? So the only competitive advantage they could create was to make themselves one of the easiest countries to invest and do business. And they've gone from 84th in the economic freedom rankings, all right, and again they overtook South Africa in the 1990s. And now they're fifth overall, and their GDP per capita is now 50% above South Africa's. Okay, they've overtaken South Africa. China's also overtaken. They're not an easy place to do business. They've made it easier than under Chairman Mao, but certainly it's one of the more difficult places on earth to do business. But they can put those barriers there because people are prepared to climb those barriers because there's such deep potential behind those barriers. South Africa doesn't have those deep barriers. Now, Chile, a country with more potential than Mauritius, but certainly a hell of a lot less than South Africa's, just under South Africa, they also overtake South Africa in the 90s. Their GDP per capita is now 2.5 times South Africa's. And they start at 60th rank, they're now 10th, most economically free country. Okay? South Africa goes from 29th to 93rd, actually 96th in the very, very latest ranking. But the point is that the improvement of South Africa is entirely within its own hands and power. It's not because of China or Greece or whatever, whether the US raises rates or not. It's within South Africa's own power, okay, to actually change. And if we actually had the same attitude as Mauritius and Chile, we would be ahead of Chile at this stage. Thank you very much.